Okay, ladies and gentlemen, members, colleagues all, apologies for the delay. We're now back in session. Apologies, we had a technical problem of some sort, which I'm sure you could appreciate. The good news is that we did have some time in hand this afternoon. However, we now have no time in hand. We might have a little discussion with business managers later if we run out of time. But if we can resume at topical questions, and we start with question number one from Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports that school menus in around three quarters of council areas include processed meats containing nitrites.
Cabinet Secretary John Swinney.
Presiding Officer, in 2018 we consulted on proposals put forward by a scientific technical working group to make school food and drink healthier. The group recognised that red meat can provide vital nutrients such as iron, and inclusion in school meals can contribute to meeting the nutrient standards. The group recognised, however, that such provision had to be made within a maximum level of red and processed meat served in schools consistent with international guidelines. The consultation closed in August 2018, and we are carefully analysing the responses to the consultation prior to finalising the revised regulations.
Monica Lennon.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and I do accept that the Scottish Government is committed to limiting the amount of processed meats eaten by pupils at school. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept the scientific evidence of a link between nitrites in processed meat and biocancer? And if he does he agree with me that school meals should be nitrite-free?
Cabinet Secretary.
There is very clear scientific evidence that suggests the level of red meat consumption that is appropriate and consistent with a balanced diet. And that is the advice that the government is following. Monica Lennon is correct to highlight the approach of the Scottish Government in relation to school nutrition. Back in 2008, we introduced regulations in relation to school nutrition, which were regarded as world-leading. They were updated in 2013. We are doing a similar exercise in response to the commitments we gave in our manifesto in 2016, and also in relation to updated scientific advice that has just that emerged in 2017. So that work is underway within the government, and the government takes that advice very seriously.
Michael Lennon.
Thank you. I welcome the work that is underway. The link between nitrites, processed meat and biocancer is a hugely important public health issue. Given the Scottish Government's commitment to becoming a good food nation, will the Scottish Government back the experts, ignore some of the industry spin that has been taking place, and ensure that Scotland becomes a world leader by making sure that meat in schools is nitrite-free?
Cabinet Secretary.
The argument that Monica Lennon makes here is fundamentally about quality of food and produce. And what is beyond dispute is that Scottish red meat consumed in an appropriate level, if individuals wish to do so, is perfectly compatible with a balanced diet, provided it is consumed within those limits that I've expressed. Now, that's the foundation of the advice that the Scottish Government has accepted from the short-term working group that we commissioned to undertake this activity. That is the basis upon which we have consulted on the regulations. We've had over 1,350 responses to the regulations, and we are currently considering the feedback from that consultation exercise. And I anticipate being able to finalise the report on the views offered in the consultation by the end of March 2019, and then proceed to the formal regulations at that stage.
Willie Coffey, to be followed by Brian Whittle.
Thank you. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what the Scottish Government is doing to ensure that more children have access to school meals which are healthy, nutritious and made from local Scottish produce, which, as he knows, has been the position in East Ayrshire for some years now, and where at least two schools now have the Eat Safe Award?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, all food and drink provided in local authority schools must meet the standards set out in the Scottish School Food and Drink Regulations, and it's on the basis of that commitment that we are updating the standards to be based on scientific evidence and to ensure that we have the highest quality produce consumed in our schools. In addition to all of those commitments, the Scottish Government has committed £1.2 million over the financial years 2018 to 2021 in the Food for Life programme to assist 32 local authorities in achieving a catering mark award in their primary schools and nurseries. This is part of our commitment to ensure we have high quality produce of the type that Mr Coffey cites in, that is provided in schools in East Ayrshire.
Brian Whittle to be followed by Mark Ruskell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And given the issues that are currently within the education or within young children in terms of obesity, diabetes and other health-related issues, the Cabinet Secretary would accept that eating good, solid, locally procured food has a positive impact on children's health, on attainment, on a carbon footprint and supports the rural economy. And with that in mind, that only 16% of the Central XL procurement contract currently is procured from Scotland. There's something really positive that we could do right now that could impact the health of our children.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, there's good progress that's been made in the dialogue with Scotland XL on improving the levels of Scottish produce that are served in our schools. That is an implicit part of the agenda that we take forward. The regulations that I consulted upon, or the information from the short-term working group, covered a range of different issues to ensure that school nutrition was of a higher quality and contributed to better health and well-being for individual young people. So that work is part and parcel of the approach that the government takes to ensure that we have the highest quality of nutrition in our schools.
Mark Ruskell.
Thank you. Fresh, unprocessed school meals can only be cooked by councils that keep open their school kitchens and invest in their catering staff. What is the view of the Cabinet Secretary of the decision made by the Tory-led Perth and Kinross Council to abolish their catering service, close down their kitchens, and move to frozen, cook, chill, processed food in their schools?
Cabinet Secretary.
It is a proposal that with which I am familiar locally, and it causes me a great deal of concern because I think it undermines the quality of produce that is able to be delivered in individual schools. It also affects employment and sustainability in a number of localities. So I do hope that the local authority reflects carefully on all of these questions as it comes to conclusions on this point. Because from what I've seen, I have not sufficient confidence in the arrangements that have been set out to justify the changes that have been made.
Thank you. Question number two, Maureen Watt.
To ask the Scottish Government what economic benefits could be realised following the full opening of the AWPR.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson.
During construction of the AWPR contract, it has already generated benefits for local employment and local businesses. Since opening the major part of the road in December 2018, there has been overwhelmingly positive feedback from the North East, which demonstrates the transformational impact that infrastructure can bring about in people's daily lives, the quality of their environment and the economy as a whole. We've been seeing story after story, especially in social media, from people and businesses using the road and seeing substantial improvements to their journey times and reduce congestion across the city. After more than 65 years of waiting, the project is now fully open to traffic. Social media this morning has been overwhelmingly positive, with comments about shortened commutes as well as about Anderson Drive being so quiet today, now the last of the road is open. The project is anticipated to provide substantial benefits across the whole of the North East and provide a boost to the economy, increase business and tourism opportunities while improving safety and reducing congestion. It's anticipated that the project will generate up to 14,000 jobs over a 30-year period as a result of opening up significant development opportunities. It will cut the journey times across Aberdeen by up to half at peak periods and reduce traffic volumes on Anderson Drive and connecting roads. This should reduce transport costs for businesses and provide an unprecedented opportunity for a local authority to provide greater priority to public transport to speed up journeys and improve reliability within the city area.
Maureen Watt.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Cabinet Secretary, as you said, the Aberdeen's Western Bypass was first mooted some 65 years ago. generations of Tory, Labour, Lib Dem governments did absolutely nothing. But as of 2007, the SNP got on with the job of delivering this new bypass fully open today. How will the Scottish Government ensure that the full benefits of this transformational infrastructure project, not just in economic terms, can be realised over the long term?
Cabinet Secretary.
Senator Officer, the member makes a very good point. There was a lot of talk about the Aberdeen Western peripheral route, but it's the SNP and this government that's delivering it for the north-east of Scotland. Demonstrating our commitment to the north-east of Scotland, alongside the significant investment we're also putting into rail in the north-east, and also the investment we plan for the dualling of the A96. Again, demonstrating our commitment to the north-east of Scotland, helping to support the economy and to help to create employment within the area. Senior Officer, Transport Scotland will of course be undertaking an evaluation of the project in line with the Scottish Trunk Road Infrastructure Project Evaluation Guidance. This will allow us to evaluate, after 1 year, how it is performed against the criteria it was set at the initial stages of developing the project, and then at year three and at year five, to assess the development and the impact that it's having on the local area. The main areas that that evaluation will include the scheme's objectives of operations, environment, safety, economy, integration, accessibility and social inclusion. Transport Scotland will continue to monitor how use of the road is affecting the rest of the road network within the north-east of Scotland. But it's very clear, Presiding Officer, this road is starting to transform the north-east of Scotland today and will continue in the future.
Maureen Watt.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary again for that answer, but can the Cabinet Secretary tell us what it is about the nature of a fixed-term contract that the contractors just don't get? And will he do his utmost to ensure that taxpayers aren't held to ransom by the contractors for mistakes that they've made along the way and delays that they have made in realising the full opening of the route today?
Cabinet Secretary, and there are five more questioners. Doctor,
I'd be very clear about the need to make sure that we protect the taxpayers' interests. I must confess I've been concerned at times from some of the narrative from opposition parties that appear to accept that on the basis that a contractor states that they have a claim, that in some way it automatically has merit and it must be paid by taxpayers. One thing I can assure members in this chamber is that we'll act in the taxpayers' interest and to protect the taxpayers' interest from any errors or mistakes or additional costs that are being incurred by contractors as a result of their own mistake. And let's not forget, Aberdeen Roads Limited spent 2 years preparing to submit a tender for this project. They went into this project with their eyes wide open, and what we will do is we'll continue to hold them to that contract in the taxpayers' interest.
Peter Chapman, to be followed by Lewis MacDonald.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I need to declare an interest as a farmer. And firstly, I would like to say I very much welcome the complete opening of this road. It is long overdue and it will be a huge asset to the north-east economy. That is for sure. However, there is still a huge question mark as to whether farm tractors are allowed on this road. Now, I have received clarification that the Balmeedy Tipperty bit of the road is open to tractors, but there is confusion about the rest of the road. And given that tractors can travel on the A90 all the way from Aberdeen to Perth with no issues, and given that the AWPR is also a dual carriageway and not a motorway, why can't they travel on the AWPR as well?
Cabinet Secretary.
Signed Officer, the decision around classifying the AWPR as a special road was made several years ago, which made clarity around the arrangements for agricultural vehicles being on the road. That was a decision that was made back around, I think it was 2014. So if the member thinks there is a lack of clarity around it, he is in fact wrong. There is very clear guidance on the special status of this road, which does not allow it to be used for agricultural vehicles for very good reasons. It was set out at the time when that was considered. But what I also do welcome, Presiding Officer, is the, I don't know if it's a grudging or just the late acceptance of the Tories that they congratulate us in getting this road complete to help to benefit the people of the north-east of Scotland, including the farmers within the north-east of Scotland as well.
Lewis MacDonald to be followed by Mike Rumbles.
Like other members, I'm very glad this road is finally complete, and Michael Matheson is not to blame for the 12 years of delay under the SNP government. But I'm glad that he focuses on the issue of cost as well as the other aspects of this important project. The information currently available on the Scottish Government website states that the annual unitary charge to be paid to the contractors, Mr. Matheson has mentioned, will average £48 million a year, that the total unitary charge will come to £1.45 billion over the next 30 years, and that the contractors will receive their last unitary charge payment in 2048. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell us whether any or all of this information will now require to be updated?
Cabinet Secretary.
Signed officer, let me say first of all to the substantive point that the member has made, there are no plans for any changes to be made to that as it stands at the present time, because the way in which the contract is formed is that the contractors are only paid once the road is accessible to vehicles, and that continues to be the case. I've been very clear with the contractors that they entered into a contract at the time, which they gave due consideration to and went through all of their own expert advisors, and they entered into that willingly. What I'm determined to do is to hold them to that contract, and that's exactly what we have been doing. And when those who have been calling on me just to get on with it, just get the road opened, what I've been doing is making sure that we act in the taxpayers' interest and not allowing contractors to try and hold us over a barrel and a gun to your head to extract more taxpayers' money for a road which they were already getting paid for. And we will continue to take that approach when we discuss these matters with them. Can I also say to the member, I think he's been a bit unfair in suggesting it was some sort of 12-year delay. The member knows very well, about the legal challenges which were made to this particular contract. The delays that caused with it ending up in the Supreme Court, which resulted in years of delay in allowing this road to be built. But what we have been clear about all the way along, we were determined to deliver for the people of the North East, and that's exactly what we've done with the AWPR.
And Mike Rumbles.
Is the public purse exposed to all of the £250 million cost overrun?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, this is exactly the type of attitude that does not act in the interest of the taxpayer. This is Mr. Rumbles. In effect, because the contractors may have a claim, he automatically presumes that it has some form of merit. It is not unusual in major infrastructure projects, for contractors to have some sort of claim that they have run into additional costs as a result of delivering the project. There is a process for that to be gone through, and that's exactly what will happen with this particular case. But what I can say is that despite the claims from the contractors, they have been unable to substantiate their claim to date. And as I said in this Parliament and also in committee, any additional claim coming from the contractors must be one which is evidence-based and can be substantiated. To date, they have failed to do so, and we will continue to defend the public taxpayers' interest in this matter rather than caving in the way in which we would do if we were to listen to people like Mr. Rumbles.
Thank you very much. Apologies to Julian Martin and to Liam Kerr, as that concludes topical questions.